Hi, I'm James Goodale, and you're watching the Digital Age. Will Al-Qaeda become a virtual state? Well, it sounds a little techie, doesn't it? But it's a real issue and an important one for us to understand terrorism. And you remember, we look at major issues and media in society through a digital prism. So we're going to take a look at terrorism through a digital prism, the most important prism I would submit, tonight with Dan Benjamin, who has a book called
The Age of Sacred Terror. It's a terrific book. It's got excellent reviews everywhere, particularly in the New York Times. And Dan is a former director, I always want to say director, but that's not right.
That's
senior,
right.
Senior director, former director of the National Security Council. And that's where the intelligence mavens live, as we say in New York. Welcome.
Thank you.
Can you tell us what you mean when you say in your book that you believe there is some opportunity for Al-Qaeda to become a virtual state?
Al-Qaeda hijacked Afghanistan and became a state within a state. But once the group's been evicted from Afghanistan, it can try to reestablish training camps and facilities in other countries, but there really aren't any countries that are going to offer them that, certainly not for an extended period of time. The United States will simply make that impossible for those countries. So Al-Qaeda's option is to rely on modern telecommunications and information technology and insinuate itself into countries around the world. It's already present in 50 or 60 of them. And using all the advantages of globalization, become a network buried within existing old-style nation-states. And in the West, this is going to pose an enormous problem for us because we're deprived of a target to bomb. We no longer have a target that we can use military force against, and it will become harder and harder to find terrorists before they act.
Okay, let's just talk in simple terms, because technology is a turnoff for most people, but most people do have computers. And most people have cell phones. Can you just picture for us a typical terrorist somewhere relating in this virtual state to another terrorist and tell us what they do in real terms?
Well, a lot of what they will do will be to arrange logistics for a terrorist attack. There are very few people who actually do the real bombing, but it takes a lot of people to set up an attack. And so you may find a lot of communications, and it'll probably be encrypted, sending back and forth messages about the kinds of things they need to buy, the kinds of vehicles they need to procure, the kinds of training that these people need to get to carry out whatever their missions are. There will be a lot of that. There will also be a lot of dissemination of propaganda. I mean, one of the most important sides of the virtual state of Al-Qaeda, and it already exists, is that Al-Qaeda is not just about blowing things up. It's about spreading an ideology and gaining converts to its particular brand of Islam and its particular agenda. So a lot of material is already on the web, circulating at a high velocity. And a lot of people are reading it, and they're entering chat rooms that are filled with other jihadists, as we call them. And so this is also a sort of information ministry that's going on. So these are the two parts of the equation that we need to keep a close eye on, and I think that this is the direction that the group will go in.
All right, so the idea is that we could have in 60 countries, because apparently there are jihadists in 60 countries, and each of those 60 people probably has a computer. Isn't that fair to say that most of Al-Qaeda has computers?
Most of the key people have laptops, access to computers. They also use internet cafes and things like that.
Yeah.
Because it's easy to send messages and not be traced.
But isn't there, I wonder what you think. Do you think there's a high probability that lots and lots of Al-Qaeda have computers, maybe even a higher percentage than people in the United States? Is that possible, do you think, because of their sophistication?
It's hard. They don't answer market surveys. But it is indeed possible that the key operatives will all be networking together.
Right. Okay, so there's one in country one and there's one in country 60. Or maybe there's one in each of the 60s, and I send an email to you and I've got 59 CCs.
Yeah, well, I probably wouldn't be quite like that, because it's difficult to protect your communications when you do it that way. But I think they do have a lot of internet communication, also a lot of complicated telephone communications, faxes, things
right.
like that. And the amazing thing about Al-Qaeda is that at the same time that it's going high-tech, it goes low-tech. One of the reasons that we've probably had such a hard time intercepting communications lately, one of the reasons we didn't know about 9/11 in time, is that a lot of the messages are also given face-to-face. So it's this combination of high-tech and low-tech that is so hard to defend against.
Okay, now, Al-Qaeda, we know from reading the papers, was able to use old tech in terms of a land base. They were able to get together and be trained. Many, many Al-Qaeda, what's the numbers pretty high?
Thousands.
Thousands, okay. So they get to know each other. Now, if we have a total virtual network, which means that the people of this entity are connected digitally, won't it be more difficult for the terrorists to get to know each other? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Well, the terrorists already practice a high degree of compartmentalization, which is the practice of intelligence services and other clandestine organizations to keep people's knowledge of each other in the group to a minimum,
so
that they can't give up the goods if they're arrested.
Right. Those are cells, right?
Cells, right. Yeah. So that's in their interest, and they will want to minimize that. And only people at a very high level will continue to know who's where and doing what, and what their actual identities are, because often they use cover names.
Okay, so what the computer effectively enhances the anonymity of their organization, because they don't have to know one another.
That is true.
I mean, you could have a computer exchange and wouldn't even know who you were talking to.
Well, there are a lot of relationships in the modern world where you don't know what the face of the person you're talking to is, and I think this is one of the more nefarious examples.
Now, let's talk about training in a virtual world. The Osama bin Laden camps in Afghanistan were used for training and making explosives. In your book, you point out even weapons of mass destruction are floating around, hijacking.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have a training camp, or would you have a training camp in a virtual state? How would you train each other if all you are able to is email each other?
Well, the first thing to keep in mind is that there are those thousands of people who are trained.
Well, I know.
And
I know.
So that means that they have a real capability out there.
Oh, that's a good point. That's going to be quite a while.
It's going to be a while before we roll everyone up. But they will also try to establish clandestine camps where they can. This is one of the reasons people are so concerned about Southeast Asia, because in a place like Indonesia, there just isn't the kind of police authority everywhere you need it, or in the Philippines, to have wall-to-wall coverage. So there is a possibility that there will be places where people are training with explosives and things like that, but it won't be like the old days where they had Afghanistan at their disposal.
Of course, you can put how to make an explosive right on the website and send a terrorist to the website, and he just pulls it down. Maybe he doesn't need any more than that.
Well, that's true, but too many people who've blown themselves up trying to make bombs wish that they had had a little more tuition in the matter.
Well, let's talk a little bit about how they communicate. In your book, you say that, this is about bin Laden. When bin Laden stopped using the phone, that's the cell phone, and let his aides do the calling, the United States lost its best chance to find him. Why do you say that?
Well, actually, it was a satellite phone. And
I beg your pardon, it was a satellite phone.
It was a satellite
right?
phone. And, you know, we have means for tracking satellite phone signals. There was a very famous case involving a Chechen leader named Dudayev, who was using a satellite phone. The Russians had been looking for him for years. They found the satellite signal, and they sent a missile riding that signal right to Mr. Dudaev, and that was the end of his career as a Chechen separatist. So our ability to find bin Laden was severely limited by the fact that we could no longer be certain that he was where that signal was coming from.
And is that distinct from computer communications?
Well, this was, you know, a different mode, and in fact, one of the problems we face is that there's been such an explosion in modes of communication that it's very hard for the government to keep up with all that. We have, you know, superb signals intelligence capabilities, but the technology is just galloping ahead, and it's tough to keep up with.
Well, satellite phones, I believe, are not, or were not, capable of being encrypted, and of course, we have a computer. Communications which are encrypted. And do you think that makes a difference in terms of tracking the bin Laden and his terrorists down?
There's no question that the proliferation of encryption has made it more difficult. It's important to remember that not only is there technical encryption, but terrorists have a series of different codes that they use, just verbal codes, you know, saying a wedding when they mean a bombing, for example, and all those have to be cracked as well. So playing defense against this is very, very difficult.
I don't know if you want to comment on this, but we did a show with Mary Jo several weeks ago in which she said that in connection with a terrorist whose name is Youssef, who participated in the 1993 explosion at the World Trade Center, that his computer was introduced into evidence, and they were able to decrypt part of it. But till this day, she said, and now we're 9 years later, the government still hasn't decrypted the computer. Now, without giving away classified information, would your view be that the terrorists really have some sort of advantage that other criminals in the past or other governments have not had?
My understanding is the same as Mary Jo White's, that there are parts of the computer that was seized in Manila in 1995 that have not been decrypted. Ramzi Youssef was an unusually capable terrorist. There have been other cases in which terrorists and their computers have been captured, and the exploitation of that computer, as they call it in intelligence circles, has been pretty effective. I'm just not enough of a technician to know, you know, if there's a lot that we can't do.
Well, you did say here in your book, without trying to press you too much on national secrets, that when Ahmed Ressam, mm-hmm. who was the perpetrator of the Millennium Plot to blow up the Los Angeles airport, is that correct?
That's correct.
Was stopped at the Washington state line with Canada, that the investigation you put in here revealed more worrisome details, such as the use of 28-digit encryption on the laptop of one operative, a level of technical sophistication that far exceeded expectations. Now, that seems to tell me that the terrorists are trying to keep a step ahead of the government, and that it's probably not that difficult for them to do it, since you can download encryption from the net quite easily. Well, I wonder what you meant by this statement.
There's no question that the terrorists are seeking every possible advantage that they can acquire. I wouldn't say that they are a step ahead. More often than not, they're a step behind. But to deal with someone who's just a step behind you can often be incredibly difficult. And so this is a real problem area, and how well we're going to be able to cope with the spread of this incredibly sophisticated technology is going to be tough.
Okay, we've got a virtual state. Virtual state exists because they're computers. It doesn't have any land. It communicates through encrypted codes and technology. That's what you're suggesting is a possibility. But I ask you at the end, by the way, whether it exists now or whether it's something we're going to see, but I want to ask you something different at this moment. We've got that state. Now, what does a war against Iraq have to do with that type of organization and its connection to al-Qaeda?
Well, the Bush administration has argued that there are links between the two, and that there is a history of cooperation of some kind. I'm very familiar with the intelligence up till the end of 1999, and I've talked to a lot of people since then and kept in touch with my own sources in the community. And I don't buy it. There have been contacts. There certainly were lots of cases of Al-Qaeda people transiting Iraq over the years. But there has not been a history of cooperation. Iraq's fingerprints are not to be found on any terrorist attack in the last 10 years, certainly since the 9 years, since the effort to attack former President Bush on a visit to Kuwait. No terrorist attack, at least directed at the United States. I think that there are good reasons for confronting the Iraqi regime, particularly if it's going to acquire a nuclear weapon, which would change geopolitics in the region. But it's not part of the war on terrorism.
It doesn't have any connection with terrorism, Iraq?
Well, Iraq is a state sponsor of terrorism. Most of the operations it supported in recent years have been efforts to kill opponents of the Iraqi regime abroad. They've not targeted the United States, and they are not interested, have not been interested thus far in using a weapon of mass destruction against the United States. Now, the closer we get to destroying the regime of Saddam Hussein, the greater the likelihood that Saddam will find common cause with someone who, until now, he has viewed as an enemy, because the secularists and the jihadists hate each other. To Osama bin Laden, Saddam Hussein is Satan.
Would you say that he's not supporting any terrorism at this point in time?
No, I couldn't say that.
What sort of terrorism, if he is supporting it, would he be supporting?
Over recent years, as I mentioned, it was efforts to assassinate regime opponents abroad. That's the main kind.
Right. Is that done with?
Probably not.
Never done with, but
it's probably never done with. The Iranians do this too. This is a common employment of terrorism. For some years, Iraq also used the Abu Nidal group to do its assassinations. But in terms of trying to destabilize the United States or drive us out of a particular region through terror attacks, there's not much evidence that that's going on.
Could we go through some of the statements the administration has been using to take a contrary position? Which is, first of all, Condoleezza Rice said on television recently that she had information from Al-Qaeda prisoners in Guantanamo Bay that some members of Al-Qaeda met with Iraq for instruction in weapons of mass destruction. And she went on further to say, I don't know what all the details are, we have to explore it further. But standing by itself was quite a frightening statement. Do you have any comments on that statement?
I'm not aware of the intelligence, nor if it surfaced very recently would I be. But I would simply point out that when George Tenet wrote a letter to the Senate Intelligence Committee about the different statements that the administration has made, he noted that this information comes from sources of varying quality. And that is a phrase that covers a multitude of sins.
In other words, after they squeeze the knuckles of someone in Guantanamo Bay, they'll say anything.
Well, what they're saying is it might be true and it might not be.
Yeah.
Certainly, that there was no sustained record of that kind of cooperation until very recently.
Now, in your book, you say flat out that Al-Qaeda was interested in weapons of mass destruction. I think that's correct. And if so, where would they get the instruction and ability to do that? Not from Iraq, someplace else?
The main source of their expertise or their support for their program was when they were in Sudan from the Sudanese government, and they were working together to procure chemical weapons. Right. And that was it was that that prompted the Clinton administration to bomb the chemical plant in Khartoum in 1998. Some of this stuff is also being done with scientists from the Islamic world who are people with scientific training who are following the scientific process to devise these things independently. They're also shopping. They're always trying to see if weapons of mass destruction materials can be purchased from the former Soviet Union. There are a lot of different ways to pursue this.
Let's go to the last piece of information that I have off the top of my head, which the administration has used to connect Iraq with terrorists. And that is with respect to Mr. Atta, A-T-T-A, who was a mastermind of the plot. Maybe not the mastermind, but a mastermind of the plot, as we all know.
And he met with Iraqi intelligence, it is alleged, in Czechoslovakia. And that has been used by many to connect up Iraq with the Al-Qaeda. Just give me your general view as one who observes that sort of information as to its validity. Do you have a horse sense about it? Does it sound right?
Well, I have more than a horse sense in that the Czech government has actually retracted the report and said, you know, actually, we don't think that ever really happened.
Do you believe the retraction? Well, you don't know what to believe and not to believe in the intelligence world.
It's difficult if you're not inside. But the fact is that many intelligence sources in the United States have also said that they doubt that this happened. I wouldn't rule out the possibility that it happened. There are plenty of meetings between people in that part of the universe who share a complete contempt for the United States. But I also find it quite plausible that this was a mistake, because mistakes certainly happen in the intelligence world too.
Now, do you think that the Bush administration has its eye on the ball presently with respect to terrorism? Let me ask you more particularly. Its eye recently has been on Iraq. You have sketched out for us the possibility of a virtual state. Are the approaches comparable with respect to dealing with an enemy, or should you have particular approaches that are different?
Well, you won't use a military approach usually if you're going after operatives in a virtual state. That's principally an intelligence and law enforcement activity. I think that the administration has made something of a mistake in focusing so heavily on Iraq because it, first of all, gives Americans the wrong impression that it's state sponsors who are the biggest problem. They're not. State sponsors are dangerous, and of course they have the resources so that we worry. But state sponsors also want to stay in business, and they never really want to use so much terror, use so much violence, that the United States will launch a devastating counterstrike. The problem with Al-Qaeda is that, in fact, it doesn't have anything to defend, and therefore it has absolutely no compunction about launching strikes that are devastating. And in fact, its ideology is such that it's undeterrable. It exists to carry out these catastrophic attacks. And I think that that has to be the first priority in dealing with American security right now. Now, as I said, there may be good reasons for confronting Saddam Hussein, but I don't think terrorism is it.
Has the Bush administration, to pick up your phrase, generally speaking, given the wrong impression about terrorism?
I think
by not directing our attention to the ability of the terrorist to have a virtual state?
I'm not sure that they feel that it's their place to have to act as sort of national pedagogue about
why not
how terrorism is metamorphosing.
Well, but who's, if they don't do it, who's going to do it?
Well, you know, that's part of what the press does.
But the press doesn't do it very. You go in your book. You say the press doesn't do a very good job of.
This is your job. Well, so scholars as well.
You know, with all due respect to scholars, they don't have the audience that the president has or the press has. Isn't it really the president's responsibility to get up at some point and say that Iraq has nothing to do with terrorism? Just as you said, we're dealing with a virtual enemy, and if we're dealing with a virtual enemy, let's start thinking about how we deal with a virtual enemy. Get your expectations up. Let us think it through. This is what we're after. Why isn't that the obligation of the president?
Well, I do think that, to be fair to the administration, they view Iraq as an enemy as well, or as a potential enemy.
But you say they're wrong.
I say that they're wrong when it comes to terrorism.
But that's all we're talking about is terrorism.
Well, but there are other kinds of enemies.
We're not talking about all the enemies we have. We're talking about how we deal with terrorists and the fact they may be in a virtual state.
Well, again, to be somewhat fair to the administration, it has been saying that this is going to be a very long-term struggle. It's going to take many years.
Against what?
Terrorism.
But they've never told us what terrorism consists of. I have to read your book to find out what it is. They don't talk about a virtual state. I don't really seriously think this is a very serious problem, because it gets the American public's expectations up that when you have a land war, you're going to get rid of terrorism. But then when we stop to think about it, it doesn't have anything to do with terrorism, and it's not going to get rid of terrorism. Even a land war against Afghanistan, the principal terrorist, apparently on horseback, crosses the border
into Pakistan.
Another use of low technology.
I
agree with you that there's a lot of criticism to be leveled at the obsession with Iraq, and that has taken the eye off the terrorist issue. Unfortunately, one of the tried and true practices in government is you don't raise problems you can't solve before they manifest themselves. So I certainly hope the government is working on this issue. That the president isn't spending time on it in his press conferences doesn't surprise me.
But let me ask you, my theory of a full participant in the digital age, whatever it's worth, is someone who can carry on an email conversation. Now, you and I carried on an email conversation before you came on the show. Then I think you understand what the virtual age is. You have an ability to understand what virtual terrorism is about. You get it about the digital age. You don't have to watch this program,
right,
which is supposed to make you get it, okay? Do you think that Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld emails the president and they have an email conversation, or any of those that are responsible for our fate have email conversations with one another?
Well, just from what I know about bureaucracy, I'm guessing he doesn't, because he wants to make it clear that the president needs to see him face to face, because after all, that's the coin of the realm in presidential politics.
Okay, talk about bureaucracy. That's the biggest bureaucratic answer I've ever said. Okay, now let's get at the question. Mm. Do they get the digital age?
I think a lot of people do
get it.
No,
do they get it?
Well, I just don't know right now.
Humility
forces me to confess that they haven't told me enough for me to know.
Well, you worked for President Clinton.
He got the digital age.
How did he get the digital? Well, then why didn't he tell us about what you've just been telling us?
Well, actually, he did. In speech after speech, the president talked about the arrival of this kind of terrorism that, as he described it, was the dark side of globalization. But, before 9/11, people were not really listening to talk about the terrorist threat.
All right, now, I want to ask you the question again. Do we presently have a virtual state which is the state of terrorists today?
I think it's an embryo today. I think we have it, and it's growing.
And so we have the misfortune of looking forward to it, and it's going to be worse for us.
It could be worse for us.
It could be worse for us. Thanks, Benjamin. Thanks for coming by. And thank you for stopping by. Come by next week and learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.